Deidre, hi. This is Rowan again, and this is at least the third time I've tried to shoot this video. On the good side, it does get shorter with every reshoot, which means a couple of things. First, it means that I have hopefully have fewer pauses to edit out because I have all my thoughts on what I want to say a little bit more succinct. And also because, well, I have everything that I want to say a little bit more succinct. Okay. And it was brought up by a friend of mine in the comments, and honestly, he and I haven't been friends for very long, but I do still consider him a relatively good friend, just because, you know, we've had some bonding conversations that I think relatively well of, and I do trust his advice. He's in the area of my age, but I think a little bit older. Not sure exactly by how much, but, you know, we're both old school, though I was mostly lurking, we're both kind of old school alt-gothic goobers, so, and considering that I refer to Murnau as a goober with alarming frequency, I tend to only say that to people I think fairly well of. Holy hell, this is odd. So, okay, I was expecting at least some of the produce in here to be not good. I'm cleaning the fridge. Creepy Corners. She's a very, very sweet, YouTube, more like video diarist, I'd say, as far as her YouTube channel goes. She's very sweet. She's very much a Halloween enthusiast. She loves spooky kinds of kitsch, you know, Creepy Corners, that's the name of her channel. To my knowledge, she does like some gothic rock and metal, but to my understanding, I might be incorrect in this. I don't think she's been much of an active participant in the gothic subculture in general, but she's very sweet, and she was one of my first YouTube subscribers to give me a shout out in one of her videos when she was giving a shout out to recent subscribers, and she seemed very impressed with my multitasking abilities. But that's fairly common in people with ADHD, and so I figure I might as well clean out the fridge a bit. And honestly, I'm sure it will make some people wince a bit, but aside from the fact that they're taking up roots, these carrots seem generally edible. Maybe not this one here. I don't like the look of this one, but, yeah, most of them. So these are called green bags. I'm not sure how long they've been in here, but, so, yeah, green bags. I don't know, you might have... Is this over here? Yes, this is... these things. Like I said, aside from the fact that a couple of them are sprouting roots, they do seem otherwise edible. And I make that assessment because my father, when I was growing up, approximately... Oh, no, this is not healthy. I don't trust that tomato. No, this isn't healthy either. I'm not showing you. But where was I going with this? So, okay, the most recent video I've done, that friend of mine aforementioned, I do generally trust his judgment about some things, and that implies that I don't necessarily trust his judgment about everything, but I feel like I'm only adding that post things just to play it safe, because I'm sure eventually my opinion will differ from his in a more elaborate way than simply, you know, I don't know, say, feelings about, just to pull an example out of my rectum, say, Joy Division, for example. I don't remember how he feels about Joy Division, but that's another story for another time. But the fact is, my friend, Elitist Joe, a.k.a. ATAC or ITAC, I've heard people say it both ways. I say ATAC because that's not healthy. I say ATAC because that's how it looks to me. Skullgirdle, RIP, she says ITAC. I don't know how he prefers it. Why don't I have barbecue sauce? What was I doing with it? Because it's clearly been used for... Oh, that's right. From the, food pantry that, mechanically separated pork. Okay, I know why I have that. You don't need to refrigerate lard, but, in the summer, it really is probably best to, simply because you don't want basically liquefied fat. And the reason I use lard is because I cannot use Crisco, and due to my soy allergy. But, ATAC, what was he saying? This, I don't trust this. Okay, I do still trust these pork chops. So, ATAC pointed out to me that it is quite possible, he pointed out to me that my point in my last video might be a little bit lost on some people, about two-thirds of the way through, where it could be easily taken that I was just being mean for the sake of it, and I don't see how things could be misconstrued in that way, but if he's pointing it out to me that it could be, and he's arguably a little bit less of the dreaded SJW than I myself, then I will take it to heart, and I will make a new video to clarify some things. Now, speaking of clarification of things and stuff, I figure that I will lead into this clarification of my thoughts with a bit of a, it's going to sound a little convoluted, but trust me, I will come around and get to the point. So, the first thing I want to point out is, as I've said many times before, I come from a family rife with addiction histories. I myself have never had such a history, just, you know, long story short. You know, like many people in their late teens and early 20s, and I've been on my own since I was 17, but many people in their late teens and early 20s will kind of experiment with drugs, and more often than not, like, this is where a lot of teenagers decided DARE was a bullshit program, when that was generally a thing in the 90s. I've heard things about people trying to bring it back, even though it was a spectacular failure. But yeah, most people who have tried drugs, like, you know, street drugs, of course, will try it once, maybe twice, and decide, eh, it was good for a go. That is, like, the majority of people who have ever done certain drugs at least once. And then you have the next largest group are people who are able to do certain things recreationally, but they don't develop an addiction for it. And, yeah, there is definitely something up with this, and the freezer is indeed closed. So, when you're someone like myself, who maybe had the fairly typical youthful experimentation with drugs, but never developed an addiction for it, just because it's like, I don't know. As I said to my aunt, my reaction to cocaine was, people spend money on this. Like, I don't know. I also called up one of my exes and to tell him that I thought it was boring, which he thought was a very coked out thing to do, but at the same time, like, in the middle of a cocaine high, I decide that it's not worth spending my money on. I was just, you know, like, doing what a bunch of people at an after party had, and it was offered, and I decided, sure, why not? I'll try it once. This is something I haven't tried before, and my reaction overall was, wait, people spend money on this? Right? So that was my impression of cocaine, but I'm getting sidetracked. So when you come from a family like mine that is full of people who've had history of substance abuse, you get to recognize certain behaviors as very common to, if not every single one, then at least most addicts. And so when you recognize certain behaviors that are common to addicts, you accept that that it is a mental health issue, more deeply than simply becoming addicted. And you accept that most people who have an addiction are using it to, in an attempt to self-medicate other mental health issues that they would rather not deal with. There are more things one can be addicted to than just street drugs and alcohol, prescription medicines. Some of them have addictive properties that, you know, they even warn people about before they start prescribing it, you know, sometimes. But then there are things that we don't even think of as potentially addictive. I was once in a support group, just long story short. I was for a time in a, you know, part of a support group. It was kind of informal. It didn't, like, spawn off of any kind of therapist I was seeing or whatever. It's been recommended to me that, you know, maybe I might want to try going back, but I've told people the only time I'm going back is when What's-His-Face, you know, just for the sake of some vain attempt at anonymity, when What's-His-Face is no longer involved in it, then I might consider going back as, you know, a means of supplementing my regular fit. So, one of the members of this support group, such as it was, he said that his therapist had once told him that his relationship with his clinical depression was much like an addict's relationship with their addiction, that he knows that he would be better off getting this treated and doing something about it, whether this is, you know, purely cognitive behavioral therapy type of things, or if it's, you know, medication and, you know, and other things, whether it's, you know, more frequent visits with his therapist. But he had become so accustomed to being depressed that it gave him sort of a joy, sort of this sort of masochistic kind of joy to identify with his depression. And that brings me around to the point that I wanted to make. Now, as I said in my previous video, when somebody has tendencies toward overeating, especially if they have tendencies toward overeating very unhealthy things and are living on little more than junk food and energy drinks. This is almost always a form of self-destructive self-medication of other mental health issues that the person, for whatever reason, is... Okay, well, now they're trash. So, for whatever reason, the overeater is choosing to self-medicate in a fundamentally self-destructive manner. And that's actually, like, one of the things that makes, food addiction so difficult to overcome, because we need to eat, right? So, if you want to trap yourself in a cycle of self-destruction, become a food addict. And I laugh, not because I find it fundamentally funny, but because it's just one of those uncomfortable truths, right? So when somebody is overeating, especially when they're overeating genuinely unhealthy things, it's because of a self-destructive attempt to self-medicate. And maybe at first they don't realize this is self-destructive. You know, they may even, like many people who ultimately become drug addicts, maybe they think, oh, hey, you know, it's no big deal. I'll just, you know, I'm just having, like, a little treat of candy and sweets right now, and I'm not going to be eating like this regularly. I'm just de-stressing. I'm just having my cakes and my candies because I'm stressed out right now, but it's not going to be a long-term habit of mine. But then, like, they become an addict when they get to a point where the assurance of, no, I'm just doing this once or twice, you know. It's not going to be a regular thing. It's going to be every once in a while. Like, when that is no longer every once in a while, but a regular thing, and they find themselves not without necessarily intending to, but somehow unable to get through their day without indulging in their addiction of choice. And in the case of somebody who is self-destructively overeating and overeating bad things, I prefaced this with addiction because when we think about addiction, it's not necessarily just substance abuses, or, you know, which could include, since, you know, food is a substance of some sort, and let us leave the fridge. So, as I was saying, a lot of times what we think, we have this very narrow definition of what addiction even is, as a society. As much as I sometimes personally roll my eyes at shows like My Strange Addiction, because sometimes it's like, you know, you're just like, is this really an addiction, or is this just fandom? So, on the good side, they branched off and they have some of the less self-destructive things people are, quote-unquote, addicted to. That has spun off onto My Crazy Obsession, I believe, is the name of that one. As much as I tend toward rolling my eyes at My Strange Addiction, I do have to admit that the producers of that one have definitely done well in working on broadening the average American's, well, you know, the average American who watches such misery TV, of course, to work toward broadening the viewers' concept of what addiction even is. It's you know, shopping does have, you know, can have addictive qualities to it if it's done in excess and in a manner that is ultimately self-destructive. I mean, we do, in this society, especially the U.S., we do have to go shopping every once in a while. And at the very least, every once in a while, for various household necessities, for food, and all of that. But, you know, not everyone is going to become addicted to the neurological rush that an addict whose vice is shopping will. So I like that they're helping in a potentially useful manner to broaden the idea of what their viewer thinks of as an addiction. And because while I can say that, yeah, sometimes, you know, people can have two addictions simultaneously, and that is a thing. That is a thing that's not just a plot point on the CBS sitcom Mom. That is something that some people do live and struggle with. One of my sisters has had issues not just with substance abuse, but also with gambling addiction. Much like Christy on the CBS sitcom Mom, it is therefore possible to not simply have a junk food binge, you know, disorder. You know, it's not just possible to have a binge eating disorder, and eating disorders do activate the same dopamine centers in the brain that that light up from substance abuse addiction. It is also possible that this will have a comorbidity with another addiction. While some people in certain corners of the internet that I don't necessarily need to name, but have speculated that the one person who came up eventually by name, or at least by screen name, in my previous video, might also have some low-key, moderately functional alcoholism going on. I think that might be a lesser concern than the potential that that this person is behaviorally addicted to this unobtainable image that they've put out for the world to consume and regard them for. And in the effort this person has made to chase this unobtainable ideal of their own invention, basically, because very few Goths live like this, and those of us who do, or at least live like the ideal this person is clearly chasing, very few of us do that. And those of us who are able to do that have a sizable income coming in from somewhere else, whether it's music and animation, a la Voltaire, or if it's, say, mass market filmmaking, a la Tim Burton. Because he is one of us, whether we like it or not. Unless you already have a secure, sizable and secure income coming in from somewhere sustainable, or at least sustainable enough. Because sometimes people do change jobs and especially in creative industries, a sustainable income. Seriously, especially in creative work, a sustainable income is not always a guarantee. So I do believe the men I named might probably almost certainly have some kind of financial investments in something else aside from their creative income. But that's another story for another time. And honestly, it's just kind of speculative on my part, but it's because, like I said, the creative industries, it's a very volatile source of income. Like, most creative people simply cannot rely on their own creativity as a source of income. Even if they do bring in a fair income for a time, it's not reliable. Like, even Roz Williams worked minimum wage at Retail Slut. Right? Shit, Tom DeMone worked minimum wage at Retail Slut about almost 20 years ago. But that's another story for another time. A lot of the Los Angeles area goth and punk musicians worked minimum wage at Retail Slut or one of the other shops on Melrose, like when Shrine still had a storefront and when Vinyl Fetish was still there, you know. you at some point you will be able to accurately guess somebody's real age in the LA area goth and punk communities by whether or not they worked minimum wage at one of a few key Melrose Avenue shops that no longer exist. Because yay, gentrification! Yay! But I brought up the former associate acquaintance from the support group who had mentioned being addicted to his own depression, because we can be addicted to various self-destructive behaviors. The human mind is a weird thing. It's a weird place to live for many of us, especially those of us who end up in the greater goth subculture community. Just about anything taken to self-destructive levels can form an addiction in the brain of somebody who may have a neurological predisposition toward addiction. My working hypothesis here, and mind, contrary to what a couple people seem to be thinking right about now, just because, you know, we all get bored and we all, at one point in our life, do something stupid when we're bored. And the stupid thing I did when I was bored a couple days ago was I went to that young woman's Instagram and had some thoughts that I ruminated on for about a day, and then I made a video, and it's generally out of my system, but I think there's a larger conversation to be had, which is why I'm doing this video, plus to clarify a point. But that's the great thing about my brain, is as dysfunctional as it can be at times, I get over certain frustrations after I talk it out, and it doesn't necessarily have to be with any particular person I'm talking this out, but I'm getting sidetracked. So, when in the course of my sidetracking, I have come to the conclusion that there are at least a few people on YouTube and Instagram, because I've noticed similar tendencies amongst a couple of other people. And by a couple, I mean a minimum of two. Yeah, I mean in the area of two or three, and there may indeed even be a couple more than just two or three, because, well, actually, like, three would be a thruple. Whatever. There's definitely a few people, at the very least. To my mind, and again, I'm not going to name names because I don't need to, because I'm not talking about any one person right now. I am talking about this goth influencer sort of hole that I think at least a few people have dug themselves into, out of what amounts to addictive kinds of behavior. Now, the former associate from the support group, but he was careful to point out that his therapist phrased it as that his relationship with his depression had addictive sort of qualities, meaning that she wasn't necessarily calling it an addiction, but that it possessed certain traits that she's seen common with people who have addiction with self-destructive behaviors that may not necessarily be thought of as, you know, your classic, you know, substance abuse kind of addiction. So people with, you know, behavioral addictions, like say a shopping addiction or a what's that thing called? An eating disorder, which, you know, does react in the brain very much like, you know, your typical substance abuse addictions do. So, you know, it's like, and this is one thing where the, you know, online mental health community and I don't always see eye to eye, because I see some people online in some of the, you know, mental health and neurodivergent circles, because, you know, ADHD is a neurological disorder. It's no longer classified as a behavioral disorder that can be outgrown. So that's nice. But yeah, so some people have a huge problem with, you know, people who don't have an anxiety disorder saying that they feel anxious because, you know, or people who don't have a clinical depressive disorder like bipolar or other kinds of clinical depression not otherwise defined, I don't know, the various forms. I do know I don't really have it, but, you know, like, oh, you shouldn't say I'm so depressed if you don't have a disorder. And I'm like, you know, no one community has a monopoly on certain feelings.
Yes, Murnau? Yes?
I don't know if you can hear him. He's so cute and fluffy. But I should probably put some groceries away very soon. I got all the frozen stuff in the freezer. That's the important part. But...
Yes? What you talking about? What you want?
He's not usually this vocal. I'm wondering what the hell's up. But you don't need to have, say, bipolar depression, or some other clinical depression disorder to feel depressed. It's just like, if you feel depressed in a certain excess, then it's probably a disorder. Like, you can feel anxious from time to time, but unless you're experiencing your anxieties in a disordered way, you don't have an anxiety disorder. And so, yeah, some of the circles I run in online are very, very kind of, and I feel awkward saying this, but it's kind of gatekeepy in a way where, you know, they only want these emotions to belong to a specific community, when that's not how emotions work. But I digress. So when my former acquaintance's therapist said that, you know, his relationship with his clinical depression had these addictive sort of traits to it, I understand that as, you know, it probably struck her as something that, you know, that she was seeing a lot of parallels between his behavior regarding whether or not they should start treating his depression, you know, through therapy, and, you know, potentially maybe referring him to a psychiatrist who might be able to prescribe some medications for his depression. You know, that like, when you're running up against a person who is addicted to alcohol, for example, as it's a very common addiction, of substance. Like, you know, when you're running into an alcoholic who is not yet ready to come to terms with the fact that they are enjoying alcohol to a self-destructive excess. Like, she was seeing some similarities between this. And that's where I say, yeah, that's where I can kind of agree with what the whole, you know, My Strange Addiction TV show is doing, is it's helping, in some ways I see it as moderately helpful toward broadening the average viewer's understanding of addiction as something more than merely substance abuse, that there are behavioral addictions. And I try and tie this in with a few certain goth influencers. And I really hate that term, but ultimately I resign to the fact that it really is probably the best word to use for a certain profession of sorts that, you know, it's different from modeling for certain brands. It's different from fashion modeling. There have been goth fashion models like John Koviak, Dana Dark, even Tracy Michelle. She did some, now she's done more fashion design, but she's also done some fashion modeling from time to time. So there have been goth fashion models. There have been goth designers. There have been goth journalists with the various magazines that used to exist and webzines that used to exist who have, you know, alerted people to new and exciting bands and artists and books and all that. But, you know, an influencer kind of brings in a, you know, it's a mix of the sort of laid-back style of journalism, like, you know, like music and arts journalism, along with certain qualities that fashion models have done before, but, you know, you don't have to be, you know, a...
Yes?
You know, you don't necessarily have to be a fashion model. You can just, you know, and that's kind of one of the... But, you know, when an influencer has built up this image of themselves that is ultimately unobtainable to their average viewer, their average fan, when they build up this image of themselves as being the ultimate example of living X kind of lifestyle. Like, if we were talking about punk influencers, you know, insert that. If we were talking about, do heavy metal fans have influencers to their subculture? I don't know. Do metalheads have influencers? I don't know. I've never really been a metalhead. But it says something that a couple of the biggest metalheads I've known have been black. And it's just, I'm just entertained by this. Yeah, because the stereotype of the metalhead is like, you know, middle to lower working class white boy who, might entertain crypto-fascist imagery for shock value, or that might be a little outdated. I'm thinking 80s metalheads a little bit, but no, like, some of the biggest metalheads I've known have been black, and that, I just find that entertaining, that some of the more dedicated people I know to subculture that has been stereotypically, or at least is seen as stereotypically white. Some of the biggest fans I know are not white. But I digress. So we see amongst the goth influencers who seem to exhibit these addictive traits that are not necessarily tied to any potential food addiction they may be exhibiting, or even alcohol or drug addiction they may be exhibiting behind, you know, closed doors. But they seem to be exhibiting this behavioral addiction toward this image they've created for themselves, which I feel is ultimately just as much of a detriment to their mental health as any of the classic addictions like, you know, drug or alcohol abuse, food, shopping. Like, we think of these classic addictions that people have been talking about, like, oh, I'm so addicted to sweets. And I definitely have a sweet tooth myself, and I went to one of the, I hit two grocery stores today because it was food stamps day, and when I went to Fresh Time, I ended up finding myself putting back some of the candies that I'd picked up because I'm just like, am I even going to eat this much candy? I mean, it's summer, things are going to get sticky and start melting together, and I probably should have had a more substantial lunch than toast before I left, but, you know, so I did the smart thing, and I put some of it back. I put about a third of it back. On the good side, it was all at a relative discount, more or less. But I digress. So, but yeah, I see these little patterns of a behavioral addiction to this image they've created for themselves, which is not only unobtainable for their average fan, but is also unsustainable for themselves, and is ultimately having a detrimental effect on their mental health, which we see in bits and pieces that come out either directly from themselves in the form of, say, like, Instagram or Snapchat story. But we see these, like, little Instagram or Facebook stories that kind of disappear after 24 hours, but, you know, so I see a lot of people, like, who are doing these little, like, behavioral addiction type of things that set off a couple of flags on me. Maybe not necessarily a red flag, but definitely a yellow caution flag, you know, or an orange flag, somewhere in between the two. Like, we are getting a little close to a red flag here. And so I see these little things that come out periodically, and I'm just like, oh my gosh, you are so addicted to this image you've created for yourself that is unobtainable for your average fan and is so far from sustainable for yourself because you don't have that stable income. Like, you know, there is nothing wrong with a goth who genuinely loves that tacky haunt furniture. I find it kind of tacky myself. I prefer antiques, and actually my kitchen is I'm leaning in this vintage, like, mid-century modern kind of look. The table and benches I have is vintage 60s. I want to say mid-60s. I also have a little shelf with wheels on it that kind of goes with the table, but I'm getting sidetracked. So, yeah, I like the look of antique furniture for my front room, and I like the, you know, sort of bohemian elements I'm gradually adding back to my bedroom now that, knock on plywood, seems to be bug-free. Actually, this is actual wood, I believe. That doesn't sound like actual wood. I think this part might be. That's wood! There we go. Hopefully, I am indeed bug-free for good this time. That would be nice. But, so yeah, I see these little flagging behaviors come up periodically that says to me, we probably have a behavioral addiction here. People don't become addicts overnight. There's often a neurological predisposition to it, though not necessarily always, but there's often a neurological predisposition to it, which may be inherited, but it might also be a learned behavior from certain family members you grew up with. I don't think this is a one-size-fits-all thing, according to a lot of the studies I've read on it. And, you know, when you come from a family with a lot of people who have their own addiction histories, a lot of people just become absolutely kind of fascinated with the way that, you know, with the science of addiction. But yeah, so I see a lot of these little flagging behaviors that, like, people don't become addicts overnight. Often there's a neurological predisposition to it, though not necessarily always, but it definitely doesn't hurt to have a neurological predisposition to it. Addiction is also fueled by the fact that it's very rare that you will ever meet an addict who isn't using their addiction to self-destructively self-medicate an underlying mental health issue. So to be an addict, it doesn't happen overnight, like I said. Again, it doesn't hurt to have a neurological predisposition to it, but it is practically always a form of self-medication against other mental health issues that one, for whatever reason, is not addressing in a constructive and healthy manner. Like, maybe if you're in the U.S., where there is a terrible system in play for not just healthcare, but especially mental health care. Medicare pays dick toward mental health services. This is why I am on a charity program through St. Joe's Health System, and they barely communicate with my primary physician, who is with U of M Health System, and I would like to stay with U of M Health as my primary medical, you know, doctor team, because I've had the same general physician since I was about 14 years old, and she and I have a great doctor-patient relationship. So, I digress. If you're from the States especially, or any country that has an awful healthcare system, and especially an awful mental health care system, you may turn to various addictions, whether it be substance abuse, whether it be disordered eating, whether it be a behavioral addiction such as shopping or gambling or creating this fantastical image of your life that you know in your... Even if just in the back of your brain, the voice is being drowned out by the bad idea bears, but the good idea bear is back in there saying, this is not a sustainable lifestyle that we should, you know, put forth to as a public image of what we're doing. And I think there is a point where certain influencers in particular clearly have a self-destructive relationship to the point that it has some addictive kinds of qualities with this self-image that they've created and put out on the internet as, you know, being this ultimate 24/7 lifestyle goth. And honestly, like, 24/7 lifestyle goth is what literally every goth who has been active in the subculture for whatever meaningful amount of interaction and years they consider enough. Like, I mean, I am living a 24/7 gothic lifestyle, and yeah, I've been a goth about 25 years, since I was about 13, 14 years old. Say 14. So almost 25 years. I've been a goth, and I was kicked out at 17, and since then, I have been living the life. And what does living the lifestyle mean? It means I go out to clubs, at least when my body is physically capable of doing so. I go out to concerts when I can afford to. I feel a practically spiritual affinity toward the macabre, and a fascination with the occult. That has influenced my tastes toward gothic literature, in addition to gothic music, and has also, as far as my fascination with the occult, that has been pretty much going on since I was 12. Let me be honest about that, because, the whole, witchcraft, neo-pagan thing, that was actually kind of trendy in the early mid-90s, and I think it came to a head around the time The Craft came out. But that's where you started seeing kind of peter off a little bit in public consciousness. So, this has influenced, various decisions in my life, being a goth since I was about 14 years old. It has influenced so much of my life that, there's no other way to say it than I am a 24/7 goth. It is part of who I am when I wake up, and put on some music for the shower. It is part of who I am when I go out on the bus and pop on my MP3 player. Yes, it's still a separate thing from my smartphone, and start reading whatever books I'm reading, because, even if you don't want to count all the pagan literature, the majority of the fiction I read is either itself classified as some sort of gothic fiction, or it has been monumentally influential on the continuance of gothic literature in the 20th century, because it didn't stop. Gothic literature did not end at, 1910 or something. It's continued long after. It is a continuing tradition. So, it has influenced a lot of my choices in home decor. Right up here by my sink, I've got these kitschy little things, but it's cute. I find these kinds of little kitschy things. I mean, yeah, do you need any of this to be a goth, living the life 24/7? No, but yeah, it doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt, but you know, it's not necessary. And that's one of the great things about us, you know, lifers to the subculture, is we find a way to make it our own while still being recognizably goth, at first glance to each other. We can recognize other goths very easily, even if the other person, you know, just, has their natural hair color and some relatively subtle makeup. We can usually recognize each other. It's some kind of essence, I believe. But, you know, this unobtainable lifestyle with all the haunt furniture and all of that, and which I just find tacky. I just think it looks so tacky. I really do. And people who have not been paid to review it have said to me that when they've actually interacted with some of this furniture, it doesn't seem very well made either, which also fuels my love for antiques, because these pieces are far older than myself and my four best friends combined. Well, maybe not that old, but some of them are, and I know that they're going to last. If they've lived this long, they can at least live a little bit longer with me. I don't know. I see this trend with goth influencers that does certain influencers in particular, certain aspiring influencers in particular as well, who just seem to have this very self-destructive, self-defeating sort of relationship with this ultra spooky 24/7. I've got to wear all the brands and have all the tacky ass haunt furniture. I don't care how unwell made it is. It's designed for goths, so I must have it. And it's that's not obtainable. And you know, it's unless you're getting it for free from the company, it's going to be a waste of money from what I hear. plus, like I said, I find it just completely tacky. I'm not trying to come down on anybody who actually likes it. Just know that I think it looks so tacky. I really do. And, you know, but that's one of the great things is, you know, you can be, you can have a love for tacky nonsense and still be recognizably goth. I like kitschy stuff, which I kind of differentiate from tacky. Look at this little kitschy black cat, dishwashing brush. I love it. I barely use it, but but I love it. Just because it's so cute and kitschy, and just like my little black cat soap dispenser. I need to do a video one of these days going around for all of the black cat, you know, little tchotchkes in my home, because I have two of these clocks. There we go. I have two of these. I have this one, which is a full size, and I have a small one in the bathroom, and one of the Depot Town stores She is ready as soon as I have the money to order me the Miss Kit Kat and Miss Kitty Kat, which are like the full size and the smaller size. The Miss ones, instead of a bow tie, she's got a little string of fake pearls, and she's got these eyelashes, but in black you can barely recognize the eyelashes, so I'm probably going to go over those with a little bit of acrylic paint and a different, in a, like, a mildly contrasting color, maybe some glitter. But yeah, like, you can still be recognizably goth and love tacky, you know, haunt furniture or kitschy little, Halloween, kitschy little Halloween ceramics like this from, I believe this was from, I think, it doesn't say, but I'm pretty sure it's from Target. You know, like, when you're putting out this image that is just so over the top and unobtainable to the people who are watching you as, you know, through your, you know, career or aspiring career as an influencer, you know, it's not only unobtainable to them, it's unsustainable for yourself. And if you become too, there is such a thing as becoming too attached to, like, maybe you go into it at first, like, sort of self-aware, thinking, oh, you know, I'm just building this up for the camera, but, you know, you gotta watch out, because, like, it's possible that it can become, like, a behavioral sort of addiction that you know you can't really keep up with, that it is harmful to your psyche to continue in this way, but you keep doing it anyway because you get some kind of rush of building up this image that is just so over the top, so unobtainable to others, so unsustainable for yourself. And, you know, in the back of your head, you may very well know that this is not going to end well, but you keep doing it because there is that rush from acting on these behaviors. And this is a reason that that addiction is relatively common to people with ADHD. Fortunately, I am not one of those people, but it has to do with impulse control and, you know, when you start doing these little, especially if, you know, with behavioral addictions, when you start doing these things, and you get a rush from doing it, it can be hard to break the cycle. Well, I do have histories with other, you know, self-destructive and self-harming behaviors, which again is an impulse control issue with ADHD people, and I still have issues with self-harm. I've managed to funnel them in less destructive means, like to kind of keep the urges at bay. I've started getting my eyebrows waxed, that's why I like them extra thin like I do. I also sometimes epilate my chest hair. Of course, sometimes I epilate my chest hair just because it's itchy, but yeah, whatever. The epilator, rather than, you know, shaving, it's got a little sting to it because it's electric tweezers, and like I said, that's a way where I'm probably not so different from the addicts in my family, but I have found that that with my self-harm tendencies, it's easier for me to keep my self-harm tendencies under control. Or at least it seems that way. Of course, then again, my younger sister died of a heroin overdose that was allegedly cut with fentanyl, is what my aunt told me. Obviously, she died from an overdose, so she had so little control over her own addiction, whereas I recognize that that my self-harming behavior, is not good for me on many levels, but, if I can channel those urges into doing other things that are not so overtly destructive, even though it does hurt to do it, it will help satisfy those urges. So, that is my discussion topic, is, like, I do see some traits common to behavioral addiction with certain goth influencers and aspiring influencers. I see these little behaviors, common to behavioral addiction, things that people do, like, you know, gambling or shopping to addictive excess. And, like, it's not just one person in particular. There's a couple other people that come to mind readily, and I'm sure if I, you know, I'm sure if I went down a rabbit hole, I could think of others who, you know, sort of strike me in that way, or at least might have struck me that way at one time. But yeah, that's some clarification, is that I'm totally willing to own that maybe I came off a little bit mean in the previous video toward the last third of it. Like I said, I don't personally see it, but ATAC did, and or at least he saw the potential in there, to which, I mean, there's only so much I can say, because while I stand behind the intent I was feeling with my words, I don't know how I would have said anything differently, so, you know, any attempt at an apology is going to be very awkward, because, like I said, I still stand behind the intent of when I said it. I just don't know how I'd say it differently, so. But yeah, what? Do you want dinner? I haven't even made my own dinner, honey. It is a little late for dinner, you're right. So, I should probably get around to making myself and the cats some dinners.
Right.
He's very, very demanding of his dinner right now. Yes, he is. And I should make them their dinner, I should make myself my dinner, and after that, probably get around to editing this video. So, like, what do you think? Let me just, like, throw the conversation topic out there. Like, have you seen something akin to, like, especially if you are experienced with people who have addiction, whether you yourself have had one or whether you've had close friends or family members who've dealt with addiction and have struggled with it, especially behavioral addiction, do you see some of the same yellow, orange, maybe an occasional red flag that I'm seeing with certain goth influencers that suggest that they have a behavioral addiction associated with this unsustainable image they've made for themselves? Or am I just seeing connections that aren't necessarily there because I might be a little bit nuts? I don't know. Let's talk about this. Like, addiction is kind of the elephant in the room of the gothic subculture since kind of the beginning. Like, you can't swing a dead animal in a room of original gothic rock pioneers without hitting somebody, without hitting four people, at the very least, who've had some kind of struggle with addiction, and I think that continues to this day, and It's not necessarily substance abuse today, but it comes across in other ways, and I do have a side thought for another video, but that's going to be separate from this, because I don't want to mix these two topics together too hard. But it is sort of something that I was thinking of when I was talking to another friend who doesn't necessarily think I was coming off mean in the last third of my previous video, but she and I were talking about just this whole kind of goth influencer, unobtainable lifestyle in general. Like, just very broadly, she and I were talking about it, and something else came to mind that would only be tangentially related to this. So, another video coming, I don't know, if not in a few hours after this uploads, then probably tomorrow. So, yeah, like I said, are you seeing some of the same behavioral addiction flags that I've been seeing, or am I just off my gourd because my brain is a weird place for weird people. Bats and kisses, sweethearts, and do take care of yourselves, and feel free to have exactly the kind of day that you deserve, and goodbye! My fridge is revolting, let's just put it that way, but at some point in your life, you will have a fridge in the... Actually, this is not as bad as some of the times I've had to clean out the fridge. But I digress, so...
Local, locally grown, farmhouse rolled butter. I remember being a small child in Detroit, and the butter plants were all in bloom, and we'd go out and harvest the butter from the trees.